Now the refrigerated and unrefrigerated trucks. What are the importance of the trucks? The trucks are important for transportation. So here, why the temperature is very critical during the transportation? Whereas here they have given the storage, right? The fruits and vegetables are living cells, as the all biological entities tends to have the respiration as a primary metabolism, which takes place, which is the major cause for any biological changes, biochemical changes in the body. Any either it is a human being or it can be material. Here in this case, you can see the oxygen can be used for respiration of the these biological entities, and it releases the mainly the carbon dioxide, heat and water molecules, as well as ethylene. So what is the effect of respiration? So this respiration is having the directly relation, that is, it is respiration is directly proportional to the temperature. That means that is, T is directly proportional to the temperature is directly proportional to the age of the or the life of the material. So in a turn, in a sense, what happens if they respire more? The tissues become more, that means it becomes very age. That means the tissues become softened, sugars development will be there, the acidity will be increasing, the acids will be decreasing, the flavors will be increasing, and color will be changing. So these are all the biochemical reactions takes place due to the respiration of the heavy respiration, the fruits and vegetables. The pre-treatment, the post-aspirate treatments for the fruits and vegetables, it is known as the pre-treatments. So mainly the pre-cooling is one of the important pre-treatment for vegetable fruits and vegetables in order to overcome the faster deterioration of these materials. So it is depicted in this way, that is, the fresh fruits and vegetables can be deteriorated within the 1 hour if it is the temperature is ambient, that is 32 degrees Celsius. If it could be reduced to 10 degrees Celsius, then it can be stored for one day as fresh as it is harvested. So likewise, if it is keep decreasing the temperature to 0 degrees Celsius, then it can be stored for 1 week duration with its own freshness. Well, the methods of the pre-cooling, can say these are all the that's a post-harvest treatments, that's natural cooling, forced air cooling, and hydro cooling. So the different methods of post-harvest treatment, that is a room cooling, that is a natural cooling, we can say, keeping in the shade is one of the practice. Air forced cooling, hydro cooling using water, the packing ice, ice will be poured on the pack. The materials, that is fruits and vegetables, working cooling, transit cooling. The transit cooling is a refrigeration transportation, the mechanical refrigeration keeping in the fridge, and topping ice and channeling ice, it's a moderate storage mechanism. These tables gives the various storage temperature ranges for different types of fruits and vegetables. We can see the apple, asparagus, and berry fruits, 1 to 4 degrees Celsius is a optimum temperature to maintain its freshness. So likewise, for temperate and tropical regions also different. It varies again, the temperature, storage temperature varies. As I told, the temperature is a direct proportion to its respiration rate. So respiration is a major causing element for any biochemical changes in the fruits and vegetables. Okay, for temperate regions, 5 to 9 degrees Celsius, for these are all the avocado to potatoes. And then in tropical regions, the greater than 10 degrees Celsius, then it ranges from the avocado, pumpkin, tomato, even tomato greater than 10 degrees Celsius, you can, and then it ends with the pineapple fruit. So modes of transportation. So there are mainly two means of transportation, that is, vehicles can be transported for fruits and vegetables. The natural refrigeration, it is a age-old technology by which we can transport the material, that is, fruits and vegetable, from one place to other place. So mainly the ice cooling or evaporative cooling was mechanism mainly used in the old age technology. When it comes to any ice, it was the practice to collect from the colder region or harvest during the winter, or it can be ice can be made during the night by cooling of water by radiation to a stratosphere, that is known as a nocturnal cooling method, nocturnal cooling method by which the ice can be developed. That ice can be used for a natural refrigeration purpose during the storage. Well, the ice cooling, ice is one of the simplest and oldest method of the maintaining low temperature of the produce during the transportation, and it is a most common used to produce the shipping of non-refrigerated transit system. And ice has a cooling capacity. You can see the cooling capacity of the ice is 335 kilojoules per kg. If you take the 1 kg of the ice, it can release the latent heat of fusion, you can say 335 kilojoules. So similarly, we have a latent heat of a vaporization for water 535 around kilojoules per kg. And 1 unit of ice will drop the temperature of the 3 times of the weight of the produce by about 28 degrees Celsius. That is, the 1 unit of ice can able to reduce the 3 times the weight of the produce of the transit material. The ice also maintains the high humidity. So as it releases the water vapor, so it also maintains the high humidity and minimize the produce losses. Both the things, two things, the operation, that is here you can see two the things, that is it minimizes the respiration as well as the loss of the moisture can be controlled by ice cooling methods. So the second one is the evaporative cooling. It's the same as the name indicates. The evaporative cooling is the process reducing the temperature of the system by evaporation of the water. Right, cooling by salt solution is also one of the oldest method by which we can maintain the temperature of these substances for food producers for maintaining the freshness of the material. Either it is a stored condition or it is a transit condition. Right, here the certain substances such as salts, when added to water, it dissolves and absorbs the heat from the water. Say for example, it's an endothermic process. Endothermic process means it is absorbing the heat. That means, so in a water, whatever we are adding, then is sodium chloride. Say for example, for instance, so we are adding the NaCl. So NaCl, it absorbs the water heat, and water becomes cool. That is known as an endothermic process. Well, this reduces the temperature of the solution. Say for example, water temperature is 20 degrees Celsius. So after acting the salt, definitely salt absorbs the heat from the water. That's the endothermic process. And then water become combined state of the solution become 15 degree or 17 degree Celsius. As it reduces, the endothermic process takes place. Right, the sodium chloride is commonly used NaCl salt, which yields temperature to approximately minus 20 degree Celsius, and calcium chloride, the CaCl2, up to minus 50 degree Celsius can be maintained if it is the containers are insulated properly. Then the next one is the mechanical transportation, that is a refrigerated trucks used for a transit of the fruits and vegetables. This mechanical refrigeration is a most commonly used temperature control method in refrigerated transport vehicles. Here mainly it is based on vapor compression cycle. The common refrigerated equipments, that is the transit equipments, are embedded with the transport vehicle since the 1957 onwards. There are two modes of controls are available in the transit of the refrigerated vehicle. It is a continuous or automatic. So continuously temperature will be R. Then in there, say for example, if it is the cargo is maintained at minus 15 degrees Celsius, then so automatically when temperature reaches to 15 degrees Celsius, it cut offs. So in this mechanical means of temperature, we have establishing the refrigeration, that is freezing or refrigeration or freezing, the cryogenic cooling and the artificial refrigeration. In the cryogenic cooling, we use the liquid nitrogen liquid carbon dioxide or solid carbon dioxide, that is known as a dry ice, is occasionally used to maintain the temperature of fresh fruits and vegetables. That is a cryogenic cooling. Why it is known as a cryogenic? It is going beyond the minus 50 degrees Celsius. So that's for the, if the temperature of the the particular environment is minus 50 or 60 degrees Celsius, that is known as a cryogenic. And it was developed before the mechanical that's artificial refrigeration is developed. So it's again age old technology, we can say. That's it's having the advantage, the highest advantage, that is it does not produce the liquid, it produces the gases over the its absorption of the. So dry ice minus 78 degrees Celsius is solidifies the carbon dioxide and has the 92% of refrigeration capacity per mass. This is the refrigeration capacity. As we have seen, the ice, that's water ice, is around 335, whereas here it is a 645 kilojoules of the joules per kg of the material. That means which is having the highest the efficiency of the refrigeration capacity. So usually we measure with the CO, that's refrigeration units measurement, that is a COP. So vapor, well, the second one is the vapor compression system, that is a refrigerated trucks is embedded with the vapor compression. So other than the cryogenic cooling, the most common refrigeration systems used for refrigerating the foods during the transportation today are vapor compression systems. So this is the skeleton picture of the refrigeration system, that's a vapor compression refrigeration system. As the name itself indicates, that the vapor will be compressed. So different types of refrigerated liquids are used here. So you say, for instance, it's ammonia or freons are the some of the example to quote the refrigerated liquids. So that is in the vapor form will be compressed to form it as a higher vapor, that saturated condition, and then it will subject to for a various process. So we'll see in this one. So we have in the compressor. From the compressor, so whatever the vapor comes out of the evaporator, it goes to in a compressor by means of mechanical pressure. Mechanical pressure, the air, the vapor will be compressed to in a higher to raise the temperature and its pressure. This higher temperature and pressure will move to in a the condenser. The condenser is exposed to in a the ambient condition, where it is designed in such a way that it is moved to in a condenser where the heat is released. The heat is released to in a the ambient air, and it become the vapor start to become a little liquid. Here you can see there is no dots, and when it moves here, that it becomes a dotted, right? So that means the certain temperature will be reduced over here in this condenser, and again it moves to an expansion valve. In this expansion valve, what happens? So that, as the name indicates, that it is expanding the these compressed vapor, and once it is expanding the compressor, that means the pressure and volume will be increased, or the pressure and volume will be declined over here in this expansion valve, and it tends to become liquid form, and then it moves similarly in the cooler condition. So in this expansion valve, so this becomes very cool liquid, and then it moves to the evaporator. The evaporator, where the evaporation takes place, in a sense the coolest the air will be moved into the chamber, and the heat will be absorbed by the refrigerant liquid, and it will again evaporates, and it will becomes the vapor. See this entire, this half of the section, let us cut this into the half of the section. This is known as hotter region, and this is known as the colder region. The hotter section and the colder section. So here the hot air, hot vapor comes in, and again it compresses, pressure and temperature increases. Again it goes to a condenser where heat is released. So here the mechanism is designed in such a way that, say for example, if it is a 150 degrees Celsius, say for example 50 degrees Celsius will be released heat into the atmospheric air. The same 50 degrees Celsius will be also absorbed over here. That is the mechanism of the second law of the thermodynamics. That is, there is no heat loss, there is no heat gain to the atmosphere. That means, so whatever the compressed vapor comes into the condenser, it releases the heat. The quantity of the heat released over the condenser will be absorbed in the evaporator. That is the mechanism of the any of the refrigeration system. For that matter, it is even the air conditioning also works on the same principle. That is the Rankine cycle. Rankine cycle, we can say it as Rankine cycle. Okay. So now we'll move to this is otherwise known as the refrigerated containers. They are mainly made up of aluminium or GRP with inner walls of steel or plastic, because it is direct contact with the food materials, and floor as aluminium longitudinal longitudes for air circulation. The space between the wall, that is a the vehicle walls, is filled with the insulator, that is a polyurethane foam, and a cold door air blows from the top. Here you can see the truck, that is a refrigerated trucks or run over here. That is a we'll see in the diesel operated the refrigeration system is having in a the part which is the compressor will be at the bottom, and this is a condenser. You can see the inside there is a evaporator. We will see evaporator. So here we can see the two segments of the transportation, 1 and 2. So different materials with the different entities of the temperatures can be transported. So similarly, there is a bifurcation has been done. So sensors are there, the spray bars for spraying of the cold air, the sensor, the movable bulkheads, and the filled vanes and shut off taps, the control box over here, the refrigeration, the tanks. They are using the two tanks in this particular reefer container. The refrigerator container, the different sections of the refrigerator containers, we can see side view, top view, front view, back view, and this is the stacking arrangement inside the reefer, and its efficiency of the refrigeration in a sense. So the heat load, in sense of the saving of the heat load with respect to the stacking arrangements, we can see. So here you can see the green color one are the sensor, the temperature sensor, uniformly placed. One is at the front and the one is the back side, and then middle, right? So here it is the top view has been showing how the cold air is moving uniformly. It is moving in the entire the cabin in a uniform manner. So this is the header stack and this is the rear view. So here let us see here the stack arrangements and its efficiency of the air refrigeration heat load. If the stack is arranged against that is on the walls, approximately 20% of the efficiency will be wasted if it is direct in contact with the walls. So similarly, the centrally loaded and attached to the back side. Here you can see the axles. You can see the axle. This is a space. The walls are left with, but header is loaded with the stack. Again, this is central loaded one is a 5% loss, we can see, since we are leaving the two walls of the vehicles. Well, here we can see that is a wall loaded. This is a wall loaded, that is a sides of the walls is loaded and the front of the wall is left out with the certain space, that is a hazel. So 15% of the losses of the refrigeration can be seen. So when the stack is arranged in the center loaded again, which is left out with the fronter, the fronter space, the side space, the front walls and side walls is left with the space, then loaded in the center of the truck, then the 0% of the loss of refrigeration can be seen in case of the loading of the stacking of this type of stacking is best suitable for any transportation of the least loss of the your goods. Then refrigeration loads, there are modes of a load. Refrigeration loads, we can say that's mainly heat loads. That's the four types. That's transmission loads. The transmission loads. In these transmission loads, the sensible heat gains through the floors, walls and roof. We have any floors, bottom, the walls on the sides, both the sides as well as the front and back. And a roof, roof of the transport truck is one of the transmission load, which is a sensible heat gained by the truck. Then infiltration load, the infiltration load which consists of sensible and latent heat load that carried into the refrigeration space by air exchanges between the doors of the openings. So mainly the space which is available at the insulation will be there in every nook and corner of the truck except this opening and closing. So whatever the losses is occurring here, it will be the infiltration load. So apart from that also there are other infiltration we can see. The product load. The product load, as the name itself indicates, the heat removal required to lower the incoming product to the space temperature given amount of time. So whatever the product which is releasing the heat during the respiration, it's a physicochemical process. So that is the product load. So another one is the miscellaneous load. The loads from the light, the transport people, if it is the equipment. So these are all the miscellaneous loads comes if it is there available in the transport refrigeration truck. So how to calculate these loads? Well, the transmission load, the mainly due to the walls and roofs, can be calculated using the Q is equal to UA delta T, where Q is heat transfer capacity or quantity, that is BTU, Bittel thermal unit, divided by hours. So U is the overall heat transfer coefficient, that is Bittel thermal per hour feet square degree Fahrenheit. So U also, it can be written as, that is U is equal to 1 divided by H high, that is interior, plus HO outterior, that is 1 by HO. So and then the rest of the wall, roof and floors thermal conduct will be taken into the consideration, then the total, that is a overall heat transmitted by the transmission load, can be calculated. So similarly, this is infiltration load, that is the infiltration load is calculated using V is equal to 4.88 square root of H square root of T, where V is the average velocity, through upper and lower half of the door opening, that's a feet per minute. H is the door height, and the T is the temperature outside the door opening minus the inside the room temperature, that is the T, that is the temperature difference, temperature inside to outside. So similar, the product load is calculated. This is mainly the physiological heat load or measure load, we can say, that is a H is equal to M CPA and TA, where H is a heat removal, the M is the product loaded, the quantity lbs, and the CPA is the specific heat of a product above the freezing point. If it is a refrigeration, it is above freezing point. If it is a freezing, it is a below freezing point, BTU per lb per Fahrenheit. And the T, it is a temperature, that is incoming product temperature minus the cooler temperature. The difference in the temperature is the delta T. Next one is the miscellaneous load. Miscellaneous load is calculated. Q is equal to 1295 minus 11.5 into the T, where Q is the load, that is a heat load, T is the room temperature, the temperature of the refrigerator. So these are all the major important formulas used for a calculation and calculation of the heat load. So accordingly, the designing of the trucks will be done as per this figure. So well, the now we'll see the various types of the cargoes or transport vehicles. So mainly depending upon the need. So we have five types of the transport systems, that is a cargo cargoes, that is a driving on a hoof or a bullock cart, we can say, in foreign they will say that run based upon the horses. And then transportation by road, trucks, mainly the trucks we are using, transportation by railroads, transportation by sea, transportation by air. So driving through hoops is one of the article from the article I have taken. So based upon that article, the specifications has been given. So driving on the that is a horse a cart, we can say that's a hoop animals ride with a 6 to 10 kilometers the point of this slaughtering point. They are using the slaughtering, that's to transport the beef with the distance. So minor the time of the duration of the transportation, the minor duration of the transportation, we can see the hours 4 to 5 hours, the deterioration can be very less. So therefore they prefer untransportation, unrefrigerated transportation. Well, the transportation by truck, the distance up to the 500 kilometers are 12 to 15 hours of the journey is negotiated by trucks. The transportation by trucks allows convenience loading and unloading at appropriate places. So this transportation by road trucks is a very convenient. Wherever we want to lift, we will lift over there, and wherever we want to drop, we will drop over there. It's a very convenient, but when it comes to the distance of the transportation is one of the hurdle for road transportation by the trucks. So similarly, the transportation by the railroads for distance over and above the 500 kilometers, if it is, so it takes longer time and longer days of the duration. So it is advisable to go for the railroads, as the it is the fastest when compared to a road truck transportation. So it is also economical to handle, and it is easy. The transportation by sea, ships are mainly used in the rail, the railway systems bogies has been used for transportation, whereas in the sea the ships are used. So mainly this is international transport. In this international transport, so longer distance they will go for an refrigerated transportation, whereas shorter distance within the island they will go unrefrigerated transportation system. Similarly, the airways also very fast and expensive transportation system, and very systematic way of transportation without any contaminations or any spoilage of the. So these are all the five types of the transportation systems of the food material, either it is a fruits and vegetables or fresh foods can be done using these modes of the transportations. Well, students, with this I wind up with the this lecture, that is the transportation using the various trucks, that's refrigeration and unrefrigeration modes, and then the material handling equipment, mainly the conveyors we have seen in the earlier case, and now the cranes and hoist and industrial trucks we have seen, the mainly the classification of the cranes and trucks and industrial trucks we have seen based upon the capacity and the distance to be traveled and the axle, that's the distinct space to be traveled. So various pros and cons it has. So when it comes to various classification, and then we have seen the what is the material handling principles of the material handling, material handling equipment. So there are five types of equipments based upon the purpose, based upon the purpose the five categories has been classified. So with this I will wind up. So these are all some of the questions. Please keep try attempting the these questions. It will be very useful for your final examination point of view or my midterm examination point of view. So please don't forget to give your feedback on these 7 questions I have compiled over here, and please submit your assignment in time, and don't hesitate to ask any sort of a doubts if you have, and even if you have any clarification to be needed, you please call to my number and I'll be available 24/7. Thank you. Thank you, students. Stay safe. Stay at home.